This is the required exercise number three, and that means on November 26th, there's going to be four groups. You're each assigned to a group. Four groups, but each you're going to present a report, and they're going to send in an email at 9 o'clock in the morning the written materials to go with this report. So the report should include something to do with the research phase, which is you to try at least three methods. The strategy phase, you should write a strategy report, and that's talked about in Chapter 11. And then the design phase, you should at least produce some blueprints and wireframes, and that's talked about in Chapters 11 and 12. So make sure you look at Chapters 10, 11, and 12. Make sure you talk to each other in your group. So you see who's in your group. And you have to divide the work among yourselves. And make sure you know somebody is presenting it on the day. And then, once again, if you're in group number one, you are writing a report and doing a presentation about your consulting work. So all of your written stuff and presentation stuff has to do with your consulting work, which means you are consulting group two. So when you're in group one, you're writing a report about every.no's website. And when you're in group two, you're writing a report about Seymour. When you're in group three, you're writing a report about News of Norway. When you're in group four, you're writing a report about the Kennel Star Casino. Okay. And you might have, as part of your research tools, you might have something like background research or stakeholder interviews, and that's when you might involve the other group. So you might talk to somebody in the other group and say, I'm having an interview with you about how you would like this website to be. Okay, so that should be clear. And there's no lecture next week and at a conference. So the only lecture we have after today is the day when you present. And we'll also, I'll mention something about the exam today, but we might have time at the end of the presentations to also talk about the exam. Yeah, this coming Wednesday. Because I'm at a conference. Yeah, seems to be that. Unless I've missed a day on the calendar, I don't think so, though. Let me see. Lecture schedule. So it's the 17th, and then did I miss something? Is there something after the 17th? Oh, it's the 19th. Okay, yeah. Then 19th. Then that makes sense. Yeah. Okay. So okay, I added two things here to the lectures, and that is there's an old exam from 2008, and this course was taught by someone else in 2008, but the structure of the exams are very similar for all of the years and even last year. So we'll talk a little bit about that after we do the lectures today, the chapters today, because there's some points in the chapters that you will see in the questions, so you should go through that. So I'll go through this set of notes and this set of notes today. go about your design process. And they say it's not a good idea to just start from scratch, but you should think about what was done before and make use of things that are still useful from before. So it usually goes through a destructive acts of creation type approach. So the problem is when the redesign ignores everything that was done before, and what you should do is actually base your new design on what was done before. So you might have an implementation, and you maintain it over time, and then you design, you modify your strategy, and then you redesign it. So you kind of do a infinite loop of destructive creation. And what I wanted to point out were some of the different layers of what changes on the website, what is changing quickly and what is changing slowly. We see in society certain things change very slowly, like nature is the slowest, and then cultures, governments, and infrastructure, commerce, and fashion art. And similarly with information architecture, there's certain layers of the architecture that are slow to change, and others are more quickly changing. So we have at this level, if I call this one, two, three, four, five, six. So I'll say slow is down here, and then up here is fast. So we have six, which is the facet of classification scheme. And then you have five, which is the embedded navigation scheme. And four, we have enabling technologies. And we have three is the control vocabulary. Two is adaptive. And then one is content services measures. So in terms of when things usually, well, first of all, this is something like this is the hierarchies. And these are things like taxonomy and indices. Search systems. And yeah, indices. I just made a plural. Cs. And then in the enabling technologies, this is like content management systems. Or search engines. Like portal software. And then control vocabulary, this is, these are the terms that evolve it's Miss Falklands. Adaptive finding tools. This is project specific guides. Or indexes and collaborative filtering. Specific indexes. And then content services and interfaces is the site content services and the tweaks to the end user interface. Now, according to the way this scale works, is that these two layers are very stable and they don't change so frequently. And then this layer is can be expensive to change. You're investing in certain enabling technologies, and so you don't change it so frequently, but you might change it if there's like a new technology that's has potential and is worth it. And then these are kind of evolving. So it's kind of like a constant. Slow but steady change. And then the adaptive, these are also like continuously changing. And then a little bit faster than evolving. And then this is the most frequent change. So when you design parts of your architecture, you want to develop things that are not going to change so often the correct way. So you think a lot about how you design your hierarchies and also how you design it, which taxonomy you're using, what kinds of indices and search systems you're using. And then you get into the specific technology, and then you get into the control vocabulary, which describes terms within your business, and then you get to designing the or making versions of specific instruction guides about where to find things, or indexes, or filtering tools, and then you make the changes to the site content itself, most frequently. The next thing is they make some distinction between projects and programs. The projects seem to be a little bit more short term, and the kind of personnel that you hire to work on projects can be slightly different than those that you would hire for a program. So in the project, you need to see the big picture for the information architects that will design the strategic framework and organization and navigation software. And administration to continue to make improvements sometimes between projects. So you might have projects that are linked to each other. Maybe one project gets phased out and the next one starts, but there usually is some sort of umbrella program for that. So whether you hire people as part-time just for projects, or if you use them as part of your in-house staff, depends on the term of the project. So we have projects seem to use consultants, but not only. The politics are, if you hire in a consultant, then they seem to increase the credibility of the project, and this might be worth something to getting projects approved and carried out. The perspective of the consultant can bring a fresh view on how to organize the information. And the programs, you are looking at a longer term use of the people, so they can be more cost effective to hire full-time people instead of part-time consultants. And the business context, in-house information architectures have richer understanding of the business. So if you hire somebody full-time, they would have a better understanding of the whole business. And then relationships, the information architecture can build long-term relationships with other employees. So so the person that's hired in can make also agreements between like different departments in the organization, between the sales department or between the upper management. And then ad hoc projects are good to maintain a consultant, and then you can sometimes work them in across other projects. And again, that's the same as hiring in consultants up here. So these are also projects that are on the fly. Maybe they're not part of a complete program. So it's more just they both have benefits to hiring an external consultant, also to keep somebody on long term. And these are discussed on page 349 and 350. And so it's just highlighting some of the reasons behind how you hire someone. And when they make a list of like what would be the dream team for somebody designing a website, this is something that is like no company has all of these people to do such specific tasks. So it's more like the people that you hire are usually able to do some of these tasks, or they do several tasks at once. Okay, so that's basically the highlights from chapter 15, is to understand the different layers and to understand the difference between the short term and the long term, the projects and the programs. And then chapter 16, the thing about this is that when the book was written quite a long time ago, and many of the tools that are listed, of course, won't be relevant today. There'll be other types of tools. But this is more like a categorization of tools. So you have some tools are going to be for assigning metadata to documents. And this is important if you have like any kind of automated program that's working with the information on the website. You want it to be able to assign the correct information, the correct documents using the metadata. So you need some sort of if you have a tool to categorize metadata, that's useful. And then search engines can be useful for individuals when they're searching the website. So you might have a full indexing, full text indexing tool, which will crawl the site and pick up all of the terms and then enable to index them, and then so people can search on the full site. And even some of the free software does that as well. But it's just a matter of how often you index it and how much detail you want to put in the index. And then thesaurus management. whole vocabulary. This is important for special industries like health industry. They might have a special set of terminology that needs to be used and in a classification system. So you need to make reference to maybe established thesaurus. And when we talked about thesaurus, we pointed to a few of those, like there was one thesaurus for architecture. And then portal and enterprise knowledge platforms, these are can be just ways of companies managing employees. For example, they might have an employee portal where they have a sign-in, and then they have certain personal My Page information, and then they have common or rooms in which individuals can access and others that they can't. So there's some sort of a collaborative filtering tool. And not all websites will have the need for the same set of tools. So some sites may need only search engines and not have a need for this type of tool. Content management systems are when you want to get in content from maybe from the end user as well. So it's more like a workflow management tool for taking in content, editing the content, and publishing the content. And again, not everybody needs to use this, but even something like WordPress is a content management tool, and that enables people to maintain a website. You can also say that Facebook has its own content management interface as well. So it's like they had maybe separate tools for separate tasks before, and now there seems to be like more variety of types of tools that you can use and not always separated out as specifically a content management tool. But there may be content management functionality. Analytics are ways of being able to measure who's using your sites. And this can be useful, especially for business sites. They want to know who's coming to the site, how long you're spending on particular pages. Are people going through from one page to the checkout page? And so some analytical tools come for free with certain software, but others you have to pay for. So it has to do with like tracking the behavior of the users and using clickstream analysis for that. Diagramming software, these are, and prototyping tools and user research and SEO engineering. Many of these tools are for the information architect designer, the one that is designing the page, and not necessarily. There's different types of users for these tools. Some of them, like the analytics page, might be used by management of the site, and then they come back to the information architects and say, we feel that this area is important, this zone is important, and you need to move things or make things more accessible here. But it's things like this are typically used by the information architects so that they can present their ideas and their layouts to the end users, to the management, and to those who will be using the page. Create visuals, wireframes, and blueprints. You saw some of this software in the last chapters. At the end, there was a link to the free software that was available. Prototyping tools, you might have some sort of a example of the prototype of the website that you want to actually use and have people test that out. So it would be basically the basic structure without all of the contenting, and people could try this out. Online user research, so you could test out how your hierarchies are made and see if those were appropriate sorting of concepts or if you need to change something. So remote usability testing, have people use different types of browsers and interfaces to see how they work with the content that you have provided. Maybe if you have a prototype, have people access that prototype from mobile devices or tablets and so forth. So like I was setting up a Google site page and found out that certain devices don't interact well with the page. So I have trouble using a tablet with the page. And this is the type of testing that we could do. And then ask the engineer in vendor firm will tell what their product does well and poorly. So you could also ask them how they would expect their products to perform. Okay, and so some of the resources that were not listed on that other page, because that was more like bar frames and blueprints, but you could look up free examples of controlled vocabularies and information about metadata. So the controlled vocabulary is a way of arranging words and phrases used in index content to retrieve content through browsing and searching. So it's like a hierarchy that's built in with a meaning to the way words are used in a particular area. It could be health or architecture and stuff. So the purpose is to organize information, provide terminology to the catalog, and retrieve information. So it's helping people get a more complete success rate to their searches by being able to find similar terms, for example. And then the introduction to metadata, which is here. This is, again, the definition they provide is data about the data, but it's important because it's pulling out what is the most essential attribute of a class of information of objects. So it's a way of grouping objects by different characteristics and being able to find those objects based on those characteristics. So metadata can be defined as a structured description of the essential attributes of an information object. And you can take a look at that. Also, we have a research-based design and usability guidelines. And this covers a lot of topics like optimizing the user experience. And this is hardware and software designed for common browsers, popular operating system, design for users, and connection speed. So these are different characteristics of how you can design your website to work with browsers, how the home page should look, what the layout of the home page should be, issues of navigation, headings and labels, text appearance, graphics and images. So it has to do with all of the issues that we kind of talk about. And this was developed in 2013. So it could be that this is like has some more current information than the book, which is like from 2004 or something like that. Quite a bit younger than the book. I could just see it. So if we just, for example, do that thing. Create a positive first impression of the website. Limit home page length. So it's giving characteristics to help the designer. It's just like a rating of relative importance and strength of evidence. Any element on the home page that must be immediately attract attention of the user should be placed above the fold. The information that cannot be seen in the first screen full may be missed altogether. So they're just explaining that it's important, it has to be above the area where you would normally scroll down. So in this page, I don't see anything, well, unless I pick it up here, I'll probably see a little bit more. But this would be below the fold, basically. And then we have things like navigation. Use a clickable list of content. Use descriptive tab labels. Keep navigation only pages short. So these are when you use sitemaps, when you use glossaries, breadcrumb navigation. So these are all kind of tips on different how you should design navigation. Headings, clear category labels, it says here. The relative importance, I can't see. Five, and then strength of evidence, four. Category titles must be understood by typical users. Users will likely have difficulty understanding vague, generalized labels and will find specific detailed links and descriptors easy to use. So this actually could be like a reference for you when you're also designing your site. You can make use of this in addition to the book. It's like another thing. A PDF version of it from 2006. I'm sure that's most current. Okay, so that was basically chapter 15 and 16. And then I can continue with chapter 18. Chapter 18 is, yeah, the chapter 15 and 16 was part of part 4 from the information architecture objectives. So there's like a summary notes, and they had some of the same notes that were in that one. And then chapter 18 okay, so we skip chapter 17. Chapter 18 is about business strategy and how you relate this to the design of the website. And a lot of times businesses are complaining that they don't have a, their business strategy isn't complete or it isn't finished, and so how can you design the architecture when it's still in progress? But the author here says that it's kind of a one, the business strategy should inform the information architecture, and the information architecture should also inform the business strategy. So by having kind of the ideas or the interviewing the management and finding out what are their key objectives, this should drive the design and inform the practice for the information architects when they design information architecture. And then the information architect should reveal the weaknesses or the needs, the further needs of the business strategy. So it infuses innovation, it creates new ideas, and exposes the problems with the business strategy. And so the author spends a bit of time complaining about how they had discovered these gaps in the business strategy. That's by talking to a company. Okay, and then he makes concepts that are introduced by Porter. Competitive advantage grows out of the value a firm is able to create for its buyers that exceeds the firm's cost of creating it. The value is what buyers are willing to pay, and superior value stems from offering lower prices than competitors for equipment benefits. So basically, there's the competitive advantage is when you do something better than your competitors by either doing it differently from what they can offer or doing what they can offer at a lower price. And so there's two types of basic competitive strategies, and that is cost leadership, doing your operations more effectively and at a lower cost and than your competitors, and differentiation, which is making your product different or better than the customer, the competitor's product, and being able to provide customer better products or better customer service. So when you can sustain this over a period of time, then that's a competitive advantage that you have in comparison to the competitor. And these are from figure 18.1. So the 18.1 is on page 379. It comes down to Porter's philosophy on competition is to do it better than the competition. Operational effectiveness means performing similar activities better than the rivals perform them. Operational effectiveness includes, but it's not limited to, efficiency. So you can do things better than the competitor. And then they talk about, on page 381, the concept of alignment. So the information architecture with the business strategy, stakeholders and interviews can help reveal the company's strategy. So this is about performing a stakeholder interview with the management. So the information architect will interview some of the management people and ask them questions like, what is the company good at? What are they bad at? What makes the company different from its competitors? How are you able to beat the competitors? And how can the websites or internet contribute to competitive advantage? Okay. And then after these interviews, this should result in something that is like an activity systems map. And this is you identify what are the main strategies of the company. So the example they used for the company Vanguard, after interviews identified that they were interested in strict cost control or direct distribution, and that these concepts were related to each other, because in order to get strict cost control, you had to have control over your distribution. And also there was a relationship between limited advertising budget. So this kind of map is derived from the interviews with the management, and then trying to agree on the relationships between these. It doesn't really say what is the most important. The things that have the most links out of them tend to be more important. They're more central in terms of the company's strategy. And then, can the business strategy be seen in the web design? That's the next thing to ask, if they already have a web design. So you might use, this is the main page of their website, and look for how they address some of these issues. So they have a news center, ask the experts why can a strong economy hurt my bond fund? And so there seems to be, there's something about control of costs, and there's also some stuff here about education and in educating the investor. Straightforward combine communication and education, so two mentions of that. And so there needs to be something here that has to do with education of the client. So he said the main web page, which is this one, is shown on figure 18.3 on page 383. And he said, first of all, notice the clean page with minimal branding. There are no fat logos or banner ads. Usability is obviously a high priority. Second, notice the lack of technical vocabulary for which the financial industry is renowned. Vanguard makes an explicit point of using plain talk. As you explore, you will see an emphasis on education, planning, and advice woven through the website. Tools like glossary, sitemap, and site tours help customers to navigate and educate themselves at the same time. So the idea is that some of the things that they found important in their strategy, they also found on the webpage here as they outlined this. Different ways of identifying what a company is good at and what a company is bad at. A common tool that is used is a SWOT analysis. So that's strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. The strengths of the company are internal compatibilities, and the opportunities and threats are external environment issues. And sometimes the company has more control over their internal capabilities, strengths, and weaknesses than they have over the external environment. So they might use their strengths in light of their opportunities and address the weaknesses in light of the threats that they're faced with. And this is one way to look at a business strategy to find out what they're good at, but there can be other ways. And he makes the analogy of the elephant, and that the story of the elephant, where there were six or seven people, that blind people, that touched different parts of the elephant and described the elephant as the part that they touched, but they didn't really get the big picture and they didn't know what the elephant really was. So they're making the analogy that we are blind, and that the strategy formulation is like the elephant, and we shouldn't just be making an assumption based on one part of the of our interaction with the elephant. So they say on page 388 that there's different ways to approach a strategy formulation and different design, different schools of design. So there's design school, the process of conception, the planning school, formal process, positioning school, analytical process, entrepreneurial school is a visionary process, cognitive school, a mental process, learning school, emergent process, power school, process of negotiation, cultural school, collective process, environmental school, reactive process, and configuration school, process of transformation. Also mentioning that the classical information architecture design has been prescriptive, meaning that the organization describes what they want and does it. And then they do, it's a top-down approach. It's planned, it's stable, and centralized. In modern introduction of information architecture and sort of a blended approach, you can have some aspects that are classical top-down, but the newer approach is to be descriptive, bottom-up, emergent, adaptive, and distributed. Moore is saying that a lot of times people build their different offerings, their branding and positioning, based on the competitive advantage of, they focus on the top layers, how they can be different and make different types of offerings for their products. But he says that this should be based on the underlying layers as well. So you're building from the bottom up based on what is the current technology, what is the current value chain and where can that be improved? Where is it possible for you to make the leadership in the market? And then company execution of the value disciplines, what is the company doing, what are they good at? And then to make the different offerings and products based on that, so to work from the bottom up. And then the job of the information architect is usually to provide all of these services down here, but the user only sees the top interface. And that the interface is based on the user's needs and behaviors, the content structure and meaning, and the context, culture, and technology, which was also talked about in the previous chapter. If you looked at, when you do the background research, you find out about the user's needs, find about where is the content located, what is the structure of the content, and the meaning of that, and how is it going to be used in terms of the culture in the context of the business. And then from that, you can build your information architecture strategies and project plans. And based on that, you can build your metadata, your classification schemes, and your thesauri. And based on that, you can develop your wireframes, specific wireframes and blueprints, because that shows you how you want it to look. And then you develop the website, which will be the interface for the end user. So it's a bottom-up approach to designing it. And this is also based on here also. You can see that some of this is the basic structure, the hierarchies, the taxonomies, the indexes, and then the enabling technologies and this control vocabulary, adaptive filtering tools and content. It will build up on these as well. So that's chapter 18, and as I said, I recommend that you read all of the chapters that we've covered in the book, which is the only things we didn't really cover are chapter 13 on education and chapter 17 on making the case for information architecture. And we didn't do 19 and 20 either, or 21. But we did the other chapters. We did 1 through 12, 14, 15, 16, and 18. Okay, I think we'll take a break now. When you come back, I'll just take a look at the former exam and just talk a little bit about that. And then you can also ask me questions if you have questions about the project.